The UN Agenda 2030 and the UN World Population Prospects / Revision 2015 clearly state that the legal migration from developing nations into Western nations is expected to be roughly 2.6 million people per year, every year, for the next 34 years, and that population increases in Western nations over this period will be 80% due to immigration. And of course, the Western nations will pay the support for all these immigrants, many of whom are illiterate, have few if any employable skills, are ignorant of law and order, and bring with them totalitarian ideologies. Could you discuss this redistribution of the global population as it relates to our Western values of self-determination and individual liberties? That's from Dory.
Oh, hey, Dory, how you doing?
Hey there, Stefan. Good, thank you. And you?
Well, that's quite a question. so it's a challenging set of information to look at. Is there anything you wanted to add to what it is we're going to discuss based on the question?
Maybe just a hint of a background about how I happen to be asking that question. Do you think that would be good for listeners?
Sure.
Okay. For me, it started about a year and a half ago. I have a daughter that lives in London, and I was reading the BBC so that I'd be on top of things. I could talk with her about what was going on in London. And I began to notice the migrant crisis. So this was midway through 2015. And there were a few articles. There was one about hundreds of thousands of migrants going to Sweden. My husband is Swedish. My daughters are dual citizens, USA and Swedish. So I wanted to find out more about that and could find out virtually nothing on BBC. So I ended up internet searching and found the Gatestone Institute, and got hooked into Ingrid Carlqvist in Sweden, who was giving information about what was going on in the ground in Sweden. That's what I wanted to know. I looked at these pictures, and the pictures were supposedly people fleeing war, but they were almost all men. And I began to wonder, what is that going to be doing to Sweden, all of these young men coming into Sweden?
Surely you remember in 1939, when all of the men in Europe and in the UK fled to Saudi Arabia. That didn't happen.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, exactly. So at any rate, I began to find out what was going on in Sweden on the ground there. And is this going to be too long? Should I shorten it?
No. Listen, take. It's Western civilization. We don't have to break for commercials. We have some time.
Okay, great. The first time I was in Sweden in 1983, I asked a family member who was a policeman, you know, what's the murder and rape like in Sweden? And he said, he worked in Stockholm. 5 years ago, there was a murder, and 2 years ago, there was a rape. So that was 1983. And if we look at Sweden today, you know, I can hardly count it all on my hand what's going on there. Honor killings, murder, drug gangs, fights, riots, car burnings, no-go zones, health system falling apart, schools falling apart, housing crisis, pension system failing. The elderly dementia patients are, I would say, kind of effectively being euthanized. Law and order failing, rampant censorship. So, you know, I kind of started to clue into this, and this was over a period of time, and I began to wonder, I can see what's going on in Sweden. Why is the Swedish government continuing? And then I started looking at what was going on in our country and hooked into a bunch of sites like Jihad Watch, Atlas Shrugs, Bare Naked Islam, Religion of Peace, Creeping Sherry. I was looking at essentially the immigration of Muslims here because a large portion of our immigrants are Muslims. Anyway, looking at what was going on in Sweden and across Europe, I mean, we can look at Germany, France, the Netherlands, Belgium, the UK. It just, I could not understand why our government was allowing it to continue. So that started another exploration. So I did quite a bit of exploration about Islam and that question. Then I started to look into, I kept reading about the progressive left, and I thought, well, what the heck is the agenda of the progressive left? So I started looking into that. I got keyed into the policy network in the UK. It's a think tank, progressive left think tank. And they had been warning for 15 years back. I read all their immigration and integration articles and publications. They'd been warning that unless strong measures were taken, that there was going to be a populist uprising. But there were never strong measures taken. And of course now, thank God, there is some kind of a populist uprising there, or beginning to be. But anyway, that led me to essentially begin to explore the left agenda here in this country, and globalization. And I started reading David Horowitz, his Black Book series, read various books, Post-American Presidency, Red-Green Axis, Refugee Resettlement Here, things like that. And then it dawned on me that, that oh my gosh, this is socialism. This is essentially that. So then I discovered your radio show about 2 months ago, and it's just been absolutely wonderful to hear some of my own thoughts and discoveries that you talk about and folks on your show talk about. But then I started reading the UN publications, and that's where things got really scary. Looking at Agenda 2030 essentially is asking for the global government ownership and control of land and utilities and food production and food distribution and healthcare and education and law enforcement, economy, technology, trade, the redistribution of wealth by redistributing people, the breakdown of private ownership, breakdown of the family, breakdown of gender and masculinity, breakdown of nation states, breakdown of law of order, and the erasure of history and the white race. So that's what brought me to this call. To me, this seems huge. And now that I've been mobilized, now that I've woken up, now that I've taken whatever color pill it is, the one that wakes you up, I can't remember, blue or red, I find myself realizing that this is the time for my feet to hit the ground running and stand up. So I was curious about your thoughts. You of course can't answer what it is that I'm grappling with, my action. But I'm curious on your take on some of these things that I've talked about and your take on the dire situation that I believe we're in right now.
I mean, I followed most of it. There was a bit of a jump at the end, which I think people will have trouble where you talk about the erasure of the white race. I wonder if you could help people understand at least your perspective on that.
Okay. And You know, maybe I was a little bit over speaking, but at one point I ran across a name, Ricard Kudinov Calgary, who was a European aristocrat who lived in the 1920s. He wrote two books, Pan Europa and Practical Idealism. And in Practical Idealism, I should say he was an aristocrat. And he is considered by many as the father of the EU. And as a matter of fact, the EU gives out a prize every year called the Charlemagne Prize. Every other year they give that prize out. And people in the past who've won it, Kissinger has won it, Bill Clinton has won it, Winston Churchill has won it, Angela Merkel has won it, lots of folks. So anyway, I thought, okay, I want to read those two books this man wrote. If it's the origin of the EU, I wanted to know what it said. I couldn't find it in English anywhere, which is odd if this is the father of the EU. Eventually, and it wasn't available in German either on Amazon at the time. So eventually, I spent hours looking. I eventually found a German PDF of these two books, which I converted to Word, which I plugged into a translator and ended up reading them that way. And one of the things he talks about very, very clearly, and I'll give him credit. There are a lot of really great things he said about, you know, Europe, the European states coming together, and that would reduce the amount of infighting among European states, which had been a problem. But essentially, what he said was that his ideal for the future would include, he was talking at this point mainly of Europe, essentially a blending of all of the brown and white races so that there would be one race, and he called that race, I can't remember, but it would be essentially brown, and he likened it to the ancient Egyptians, and that this would essentially reduce the average intelligence, which would make that group more easily controlled by this larger organization of people that he deemed would be spiritually superior to the general masses and could hold the fort down for the general masses until they developed enough to, you know, whatever. So that's why I said the genocide of the white race.
Well, this is so in his book, Practical Idealism. This is from 1925.
1923, I believe it was published. I'm not going to swear to it.
All right. This is from Wikipedia. He describes the future of Jews in Europe and of European racial composition with the following words: "Quote, the man of the future will be of mixed race. Today's races and classes will gradually disappear owing to the vanishing of space-time and prejudice. The Eurasian Negroid race of the future, similar in its appearance to the ancient Egyptians, will replace the diversity of peoples with the diversity of individuals. Instead of destroying European Jewry, Europe, against its own will, refined and educated this people into a future leader nation through this artificial selection process. No wonder that this people, that escaped ghetto prison, developed into a spiritual nobility of Europe. Therefore, a gracious providence provided Europe with a new race of nobility by the grace of spirit. This happened at the moment when Europe's feudal aristocracy became dilapidated, and thanks to Jewish emancipation." Is that sort of similar to what you're talking about?
Yes, exactly.
Okay. Right. Right. And I mean, it would also be the eradication of the genetics of the races who came as well, right? If it's all going to be one big blend, then it would basically be the end of all races, right?
Yes. And you're really right about that. And I was being sort of centric.
I thought everyone liked the diversity.
Yes. Yes.
Right. I mean, if you mix all the colors together, you have no particular colors, right?
So yes. Yes.
Right. Just before we get into it, how's your daughter doing?
Well, she's doing really well. I've tried to talk with her a little bit about some of these things, and you know, I'm kind of kicking myself a bit. We didn't have money for private education of any sort, so the best I could do for them, she participated in the International Baccalaureate program in high school. Unbeknownst to me at the time, the curriculum was really a curriculum that is sort of a global curriculum that supports, very, very many of these ideas that are being espoused in the Agenda 2030. And then she went on to do a master's degree in colonial literature. So looking at writings of people who were colonized in Africa and the Middle East. So, I hinted that I might be voting for Trump, and, you know, all hell broke loose. So, you know, that's kind of personal, but she has a lot of this the ideals I think, without any clue what it's going to mean as far as how this works out for her. And of course, I'm a mom, and I'm reading that Islam and ISIS have said they're going to be using chemical weapons in London, and of course that's a bit scary. So, but she's fine. She's good. She's healthy. She's working. She's got a great relationship. She has friends. So she's good. Long answer.
Okay. All right. Friends won't help her against chemical attacks, but I know what you mean. Yeah. I know what you mean. It's good that she has friends. All right. So I'll give you my thoughts.
Okay.
And then you can let me know what you think of my thoughts. The disparity between the West and other... Sorry, let me start this again. The disparity between high IQ and lower IQ countries, civilizations, cultures, whatever you want to call them. Because you can't just say the West, you know. I mean, Japan, other than its massive debt, is, you know, fairly civilized. And it's going through that high IQ hollowing out of the demographics, right? As the young people just don't want to have kids and all of that. China is becoming more civilized and in some ways is freer than certain areas in the West, right? This book that you were talking about, there was a European publisher who wanted to publish a copy, and the police descended and grabbed the only copy they had, and, you know, all that. So not particularly free. So since the cultures first began colliding into each other a couple of hundred years ago, there has been this immense frustration, this staggering frustration. Why is it not possible to transfer Western culture to other cultures, right? I mean, why? The goal of a lot of colonialism from the Western powers, it was called the white man's burden, which is like, wow, we happen to come across all of these wonderful things, or discover all of these wonderful things, or inherit all of these wonderful ideas, you know, free markets, science, separation of church and state, and private property, and the rule of law and common law. We have this treasure. And the goal, it was not perfectly executed, of course, but the goal was to go out and share the goodies with the rest of the world, to go to India, to go to Africa, to go to other places, China, and to share these goodies with the rest of the world. And there was Christianity involved in the motivation for that transfer, but there is also benevolence, and there was, of course, some rapacious and predatory aspects. But generally, where the European, well, where the British powers went, and it's the only one I've studied really in great detail, where the British powers went, there was an improvement in the local circumstances. So there's this idea that we were like rich children, just happened to inherit a whole bunch of money. There's poor people around. Let's just go and, you know, help these poor people. Right? That the only difference between the rich cultures and the poor cultures is the money. Right? It's like this old saying or exchange between F. Scott Fitzgerald and Ernest Hemingway. I think I can't remember who said what to who, but one of them said to the other, "The rich aren't like you and me," and the other one said, "Well, yeah, they have more money." That is such a foundational question. What is the difference, say, between sub-Saharan Africa and Western Europe? And is it possible to transfer all of the good stuff from Western Europe to sub-Saharan Africa? And for the past few hundred years, and in particular over the past 60 years or 70 years, there has been this massive effort to take the goods of the West and give them to the world, to hand them over, to help set up the structure, to help, you know, massive transfers of intellectual property, massive transfers of capital and investment and technology and patents and medicines and you name it. You back up the truck of Western glory, beep, beep, pour it into the gaping mouths of the third world.
Mm-hmm.
And what's happened? How has this all gone? Trillions and trillions of dollars poured into the third world. For what? And this It hasn't really solved the problem at all. Now, there is improvement. And the improvement is, in particular, I'm thinking about China and India, right? You've got 50,000 people a month coming into the middle class. So there have been some improvements. But the problem is, human biodiversity remains, I think, the most significant barrier and danger, a lack of recognition, right? The fact that there is human biodiversity at the moment, and by this I mean that not all ethnicities have the same levels of what is traditionally measured in the West as IQ, which is fairly predictive of success individually and as a culture. And it doesn't transfer in the way that we want. Now, whether the IQ differences are genetic or environmental, at this point doesn't hugely matter. Because there's nothing that we can think of doing that we haven't already tried. So, there is this, the West has been unable to replicate itself in other cultures, in other countries, in other continents. And the question is why? Now, there used to be an answer, which was fairly well understood, which is that, well, you know, the races are different, right? Some are bigger, some are stronger, some are faster, some are smarter. And of course, you would expect, separated by, you know, 50 to 150,000 years of evolution in wildly disparate environments, that there would then be a difference, a branching, a difference in specialization. This used to be accepted and understood. And then the left came along and said, no, it's all environmental. That number one, they said, it's all environmental. We're a blank slate, and we are molded and shaped by our economic environment. That's it. Mm-hmm. And they also said that the rich are rich because they steal from the poor. They exploit the poor. Right. The capitalist with his big fat belly and his monocle and his gold watch and his cigar and his top hat is stealing from the workers. He has $1 million because 1 million workers each have $1 less. Now, when you combine the dominance of the left intellectually, and this really has been going on for about 150 years, I mean, it's accelerated, obviously, it's reaching its fruition at the moment, which is why these culture wars are erupting so ferociously. But the left, I mean, there's kind of an iron rule of organization. All organizations drift to the left incessantly. And sometimes it feels irrevocably. And I think this is driven by the state, which is one of the reasons why I have my beliefs about it. But this idea that everything's environmental and that the rich are only rich because they've stolen from the poor, when you look at the world through that lens, then you look at the West as evil and predatory and exploitive, and that sub-Saharan Africa would be exactly like Denmark, except that the Westerners came and stole all the resources, right? Just parachuted in, grabbed everything, and took it all back to Europe. And that's why sub-Saharan Africa is so poor. And that's why Europe is so rich, they stole it all. Now, of course, the fact that sub-Saharan Africa wasn't exactly swimming in wealth before the Europeans came along, and the fact that the life expectancy has increased, the population has increased, the GDP, while under European rule, increased, all the stuff I've talked about many times before, the fact that new technologies and new wealth and new investment, new opportunities, railroads, roads, medicine, cars, you name it, was all brought there, doesn't matter. And this frustration, oh God, it's like we're drowning in this delusion, this frustration. And I understand it's very painful. Human biodiversity is one of the most painful, jagged little pills that I've ever had to swallow. And it is, the before and after that is night and day.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so this incredible frustration, looking at the wealth of the West, looking at the poverty of the third world and saying, they stole it from us, they owe it back to us, those bastards, right? Like there are people who genuinely believe that the wealth of America was built on slavery. I mean, built on slavery. Madness. I understand where it's coming from, because you look at the black community in America and you see the, you know, high crime rates and the low income and low savings and so on. And then you look at the whites or the East Asians and say, well, they're much richer, much because they stole from us. That's what happened. We were ripped off. The white devils came in, pillaged our resources, pillaged our gold, pillaged our people, pillaged our land, stole from us. And this creates an enormous amount of rage and frustration and anger and hatred towards the Europeans, towards the Western, towards the whites. It's like Iago just whispering in people's ears saying, well, you're poor because those pale devils over there are rich. They stole from you. Now, are you just going to sit there and take it, or are you going to go and get it back? And that is, I believe, where things stand at the moment, that Europeans are thieves, predators, devils, genocidal, murderous, pale-necked, deep in blood. And they owe the world. Redistribution of wealth, redistribution of wealth. Now, the phrase redistribution of wealth is one of these very sinister phrases, because of course it implies that the wealth was somehow distributed to begin with. No, the wealth was created, the wealth was earned through people operating in a free market which respected property rights. And redistributed, well, you inherited it, we're just going to carve it off. And no, it was created. I mean, if we talk about the redistribution of sexual access, we would understand we'd be talking about institutionalized rape. Because, yes, you know, vaginas weren't distributed, like, yeah, handed out like clamshells at the beginning. Yeah, you got some extra. Share it around, right? So, if, as the leftists believe, it's all environmental, then, of course, when you take people from the third world and put them in the first world, their children will grow up just like first worlders, right? If you take people from the Middle East and you take them to Sweden, then their children will grow up in Sweden and will be just like the Swedes, and the native Swedes.
And as
go ahead.
As a matter of fact, they're finding that second and third generation immigrants are actually more radicalized, more angry, more violent than their parents and grandparents ever were. Of the immigrant population,
sure,
across Europe.
And this is exactly what you would expect from human biodiversity, which is that the smartest immigrants will come across to the West, but then their children, if there are genetic bases to disparities in intelligence, the smartest will come to the West. Let's say that the top 1% of Somalians will come to the West, but then their children will be a regression to the mean and will be much more like the general population of Somalia than the outliers, the exceptions to the average, who came across to the West. And I've talked about this before. You've got some extraordinarily tall Chinese guys who come over and play basketball. Now, their children are taller than average, but they're not as tall as their parents. And it's a regression to the mean. This is sort of natural and helps very intelligent parents understand that their kids may not be exactly like them, all this kind of stuff, right? And we've seen this in general, right? We've had Dr. Jason Richwine on the show a number of times. He's done significant analyses of multi-generational patterns within the Hispanic community that comes into America, of course. And he's found that there is a regression to the mean, that the parents don't do as well, the kids do better, but the kids do worse, right? The parents don't do as well because they're new, less educated, language barriers, and so on. Their kids do better because they have all those advantages, but then there's a regression to the mean in the third generation, which then it declines. And all of this is god-awfully true. It's horribly true. I mean, I would tell you this. There is nothing I would rather be wrong about than human biodiversity.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, every time a study comes up, I'm like, please, Jesus, can a brother get an equalization? Can a brother get a not regression to the mean? Right? Yeah. It's welfare usage, right? First generation uses some welfare, second generation uses less, third generation uses more. Regression to the mean. I would love to be wrong about all of this.
As would I.
Because if I'm wrong about this, fantastic. I mean, then things can go relatively nicely. If I'm not wrong about this, and so far the evidence is accumulating to the point where it seems like it's starting to doubt gravity to think about it. But it means that diversity plus proximity equals war.
Yes, yes.
This is what it means. Sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, there's another point too, and this is true of so many people that I know in Europe. So many people have a really good heart, and they really want to help, and they really believe that bringing these folks in is the best way to help them. And they're sort of their own worst enemy that way. We are. I've said for years and years, I gladly, and I do, share my wealth with people who are less fortunate. But what it's looking like now in Europe is that the life of law and order and values and safety and education and those kinds of things are getting crushed in this clash of civilization.
But this is not the fault of the immigrants, and fundamentally it's not even the fault of the governments. The governments are going to do what governments are going to do. They're going to try and win brownie points and virtue signal, and they're going to avoid negative attention from the press, because that's what politicians are, pathologically hypersensitive to negative opinions from people they fear. They don't fear white people, right? I mean, they fear journalists. But here's the thing. The West has only appeared to be strong. It has only had the illusion of strength, because the West has not been the West for 150 years. What we're seeing now, it's like this giant mansion. It's like you only see it from the outside. It looks strong. It's been there for hundreds or thousands of months. But inside, the termites have been working away, and the termites have been chewing, and the termites have been undoing and breaking down all the load-bearing walls. And then what happens is somebody gets drunk, falls against the wall, and the whole thing falls down, and we say, it's the drunk guy's fault. No. No, it's the lack of maintenance. It's the fact that nobody dealt with the termites for 150 years.
Yep.
That's the problem. It's not what's happening now. It's what has been happening before. This is the end result. You know, it's when you crack a whip, whoosh, right? It's that last little whoosh at the end that makes the sound.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But it's the whole arm, it's the whole whip, and then you get this one little thing at the end. And this whip, this what we're seeing now is the crack, but the thing's been in motion for 150 years or more. Since the governments took over education and currency, it has not been the West. It has been the fall of Rome. It has not been the West is dead already. This is the twitching of the posthumous corpse. Right, so we can't say, well, the West is failing. This is what happened. Well, we gave our children to the government to be educated, and of course then the government teaches all the children how wonderful the government is and how amazing redistribution is and how taxation is essential, and then you raise all of these people who look not to themselves or to freedom or to their community for solutions. They look to the state. Ah, the big, giant, glorious Gabriel bloody tunicked state is going to solve all our problems. It's going to control the currency. It's going to control the children. It's going to control the environment. It's going to regulate. It's going to manage the roads. It's going to manage the plumbing. It's going to manage the water. It's going to manage. Oh, and as Lenin said, once you get the government to take over healthcare, Well, once the government has healthcare, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? What are you going to do? But it's the control of the currency that is the fundamental reality. If the government didn't control the currency, then there would be the successive drag on the ever-ascending helium balloon of government power. There would be this drag of mathematical reality pulling it back down to the ground. But that, because the government can print its own money and borrow ad infinitum and set up unfunded liabilities deep into the future, that there's been no check on the power of the state. So it was 150 years ago or so that government education came in for the most part. It was a little over 100 years ago that central banking, government control of the fiat currency came in. The West was dead since then. There was no more free market. You know, the socialists say they want to control the means of production and we think it's factories. No, 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 no. It's not factories. It's not capital equipment. It's not machinery. Control over the means of production is controlling the money. The currency is the means of production. Once you socialize the money, once you turn the money into a central planning, communistic, fiat monopoly, toilet paper factory, once the government controls the money, the culture, the civilization, the liberties, the freedoms are already dead. For the last 150 years, there has been but three words to describe the West. Dead man walking. So why do we have a migrant crisis? Because people surrendered the autonomy of their states to the central planners in Brussels. That's only one part of it. But the fundamental reason we have a migrant crisis is because of warfare and welfare. The warfare, welfare state has produced the migrant crisis. Number one, of course, by the endless wars in the Middle East, destroying and destabilizing the countries. And boy, you think we've got a problem with exploding migrants. How about the Middle East, which has drones and exploding bombs and the destruction of their healthcare system and the destruction of sanitary systems and in a very hot climate? And good God.
I know.
Good God.
Yeah.
Right? I mean,
yes.
What is being done unto the West is very little compared to what has been done unto the East. Oh, no, somebody drove a truck down. Terrible. Terrible. But at least they're not bunker busters falling from 20,000 feet up in the air. So the warfare state destabilized the Middle East, destroyed the cultures, destroyed the countries, and the welfare state then created a giant vacuum of free stuff, which pulled all of the people from the destabilized countries into the West. How can you blame them? In Iran, you make 1/10 to 1/20 a month than you can get for free in Germany, in the welfare state. So the warfare state destroys the countries and the welfare state brings in the people, the young men. And I understand, yes, of course, there's something in Islamic teachings around, you know, it's a very virtuous act to go to new countries and attempt to move the needle towards Islam. And I get all of that.
Mm-hmm.
But that's been the case in Islam for a long time. Still never worked in Europe. So once Europe, once the West gave up our children to the government and gave up our currency to central bankers, everything that has followed is inevitable. They can afford these endless wars because they can print the money. They can afford to have these endless wars and a welfare state because they print the money. And until we can gain control back of the money, the lifeblood, money is civilization. Money is what it is to have a culture. Private money is the only way a culture can survive, because it's the only way it can push back viscerally against being lied to. Because people like you, like me, before we woke up,
mm-hmm.
we sought our everyday pleasures and we kind of figured that we were in this general inertia of lackadaisical improvement that was going to go from here to eternity.
Exactly. Yep.
And then when we find out about the demographic winter, when we find about the, you know, Marxist penetrations of feminism, when we find out about fiat currency, find out about the warfare welfare state, find out about the rampant vote buying, colloquially referred to as democracy, we begin to wake up. Now, you do that because you have a daughter who you believe may be in harm's way. I do that for my own particular reasons and purposes. But the reality is most people won't wake up until disaster is upon them. And it's like this old Far Side cartoon I've talked about before. One caveman is this big giant wall of ice, like 3 feet from a cave. And one caveman looks to another and says, "Say, thank, is that wall of ice look closer to you today?" I mean, they're still, it's the cave, 3 feet from the cave. And so when are people going to wake up? Well, They're going to wake up when the government runs out of money. And when the government runs out of money, there will be no funds with which to pay the welfare state. And when there are no funds with which to pay the welfare state, there will be riots. And when there are riots, the government will have a choice. The government will either crack down on those riots and attempt to restore significant order, and there won't be any more of these 55 no-go zones in Sweden or anything like that, which is basically, it's not Europe anymore. It's not Europe. There are massive areas in Europe. They're not Europe anymore.
No, it's true.
I mean, the police don't go there. There's no control. There's no, I mean, it's Sharia law. I mean, it's not Europe anymore. It's not Europe. And when they run out of money, they will end up paying those they consider the most dangerous. Like, if you have $1,000 left, and you owe $1,000 to a nice guy, and you owe $1,000 to the mafia, who are you going to pay?
Yeah, the mafia, naturally.
Right, right. So the most peaceful in society are going to get their services cut the most, and the groups that the government is most afraid of are going to get paid the most, and this is going to, at some point, provoke spillover tensions. Of course, it is my hope and my goal that this stuff can be resolved peacefully as time goes by. And the European governments, they're doing the insane things that governments do. It's perfectly sane in the pursuit of the immediate drug called power. So they consider not the migrant crisis to be the problem, but any questions or concerns about the migrant crisis. That's the problem. That's what needs to be attacked. That's what needs to be policed. That's what needs to be thrown. Yeah, those are the people who need to be thrown in jail, right? And they know that because if they try to go and enforce Swedish law or German law in these no-go zones, what's going to happen? Well, it's going to be Little Mogadishu all over again, in my humble opinion. Mm-hmm. So they don't want to do that because then you see there are pictures in the newspaper of people not doing well. And there'll be white policemen and there'll be non-white people on the receiving end of police power, and it'll be splashed all over the newspapers.
Well,
and racist and Islamophobic and I don't know, whatever other kind of stuff can be thrown. And then everybody will be shocked and appalled and horrified and right.
Yep. It just happened over this New Year's in Germany. I forget which city it was, but maybe Berlin. The police were trying to keep order, and essentially they were profiling. That is, they were not letting certain folks in who were known to be dangerous, who were known to have criminal records and that sort of thing. And there was a huge backlash about the racial profiling and the racism and Islamophobia, et cetera, et cetera. I don't know if you've read about that.
Oh yeah, no. And where was it? Someplace in Europe, 1,000 cars were set fire to. But it's just economic warfare. So why are they setting fire to cars? Well, because it harms the economy of the host nation. And you know, from the Middle Eastern perspective, I dare say from the Muslim perspective, if somebody said to me, "Well, you can escape this poor country with," you know, either being bombed or armed, or, you know, even if it's not being bombed, there's always that threat. And you can go to the country that has been bombing your fellow Muslims, and you can then sit on its welfare and help to destroy its economy, because when its economy is destroyed, there won't be any more bombings in the Middle East. I can really, really understand that perspective.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, if you got to go, it would be the most boring Star Wars movie ever. But if the Death Star had big, giant welfare programs, and when they run out of money, they couldn't fire their giant lasers and blow up planets, yeah, a lot of Luke Skywalkers would be like Luke couch sitters. Luke, hey, let's get a free MacBook Air and, you know, surf websites. They would go over and they would drain the resources off the Death Star so that the Death Star would stop its deadly march through various star systems. So I can, you know, I can perfectly understand. But it's the West. We betrayed our own values. We betrayed everything that made the West the West, and we've done it over the last 150 years. And we have put sentimentality ahead of reality. We've put delusion ahead of truth. We've put government power ahead of cooperation. We have surrendered more and more of our lives to the power and coercion of the state. We have more and more regulations. We have an insane tax code. We have an absolutely unnavigatable legal system. We have decided to sell off the futures of our young in order to buy peace in the here and now. Because it only takes one generation of the welfare state for any solution to the welfare state to be rife with violence. Because once you get that second generation growing up in the welfare state, if you start to reduce the welfare state, they're going to riot. They're going to burn things down. They're going to be, it's going to be blood in the streets.
Yep.
And politicians, what they want is 5 more minutes of not being called racist. They want 5 more minutes of pretend peace. That's all they want. And it is the betrayal of those who came before us that has handed us this corpse that we are now trying to shock back into life. But no, the West has betrayed its values, all the values that made it great. And yes, I will include Christianity in that in many ways. So the West has betrayed its values for many generations. And now a lot of people are complaining that things don't seem to be going well. Well, it's not one cigarette that kills you, it's 30 years.
Yep, I'm going to have to say that I agree with you on that. And you know, your image of the whip, and it's the very tip of the whip that makes the sound and is the part that cracks and injures the body. That actually makes a lot of sense. You know, I think a lot about Sweden. I actually know a little bit more about Sweden than I do about my own country here. And they've had this welfare state now for quite a number of decades. And although in my husband's grandparents' time, they were all farmers, and they traded food and they traded fish and they traded handwork and they cooperated with one another. So they were actually, they did have a real solid base of a society at that time.
Well, I'm sorry to interrupt, but here's the challenge. First of all, the welfare state is much better done in private charity, because private charity has standards, and private charity can differentiate between people who've just had bad luck versus people who are just stupid and doing bad things, right? So somebody who gets ill unexpectedly and they didn't happen to be covered for some in their health insurance, okay, help those people, absolutely, right? But some guy who takes his paycheck and goes and blows it betting on the ponies and getting drunk, you don't want to subsidize that, right? So this question of the welfare state is, for one thing, privately, you need to do it because you don't want to subsidize bad behavior, but you do want to help people who genuinely need it, and only private charities can do that. But that's not even, to me, the most important aspect. Even if you have the governments running the welfare state, the problem is that the welfare state is very appealing to people, I would guess, IQ 85 and below. Because IQ 85 and below, you're more likely to make more money off the welfare state than you are going to get a job. And if you're IQ 85 or below, the jobs you're going to get, they're not going to be great. You're not going to be designing a lot of skyscrapers, and you're not going to be running a lot of reality shows. Running, you're just not going to get great jobs with that level of intelligence. So if you have a high IQ population, then there are very few people who fall into that category of IQ 85 or below. And that means that the welfare state, while negative and a kind of slow dysgenic drag on society, is not particularly quickly catastrophic. But if you have a population that is coming in that is, and again, I'm just IQ 85 or some arbitrary thing, could be higher, could be lower, whatever. It's just, we need a number. But when you have a bunch of people coming in who fall at or below that, then you have a problem.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right? Because they are going to come in and sit on welfare. And we can see this. I've got the truth about immigration and the welfare use by Europeans is vastly below the welfare use by Hispanics and so on and blacks. Right? So this is the problem, that the people who are less intelligent need more immediate cues and have a tougher time saying to themselves, well, you know, I can go on welfare now, but I'm going to be kind of sitting at the same income in 10 or 20 years. And what if the welfare state runs out of money? And what if I get bored and so on? Well, you know, you and I would probably get very bored sitting around with nothing to do all day. But if you're IQ 85 or lower, it's a pretty good time. Not a lot of complaints, not a lot of people saying, I can't stand welfare, it's too boring. I'd rather have any kind of job than that, right? And so this is part of the human biodiversity again. So Japan has a welfare state, right? But they don't have a lot of people on the welfare state because the average IQ in Japan is well north of 100. But if they brought a bunch of people in, like Australian Aboriginals with what, IQ 67, how many of the Aboriginals would end up working at Mitsubishi or Sony or whatever it is as product engineers or designers? Well, virtually none. And very quickly, they would have a lot of kids, right? Because you have the welfare, right? More kids, more welfare. They have a lot of kids. And so the welfare state, although immoral and bad and wrong, is relatively not as disastrous in a high IQ population. But here's, this is the great horror and tragedy of what's going on in the West at the moment, which is this, that at a time when automation is stripping opportunities out from under the noses of lower IQ people,
yeah,
the West is massively importing low IQ populations of all the times. You know, if it was some big giant agricultural society, okay, it would sort of delay automation. It would delay, you know, combine harvesters and stuff. But at least, what's going to happen? I mean, in Japan, insurance underwriters are being replaced by robots. It's not just menial labor anymore. Even white collar jobs are falling to automation at a time when society has enough of a challenge figuring out with increasing automation, which is being accelerated by all the barriers to hiring people effectively and efficiently and all the ways in which governments artificially raise the price of labor and all that. At a time when we desperately need fewer lower IQ people in an increasingly automated society, what are governments doing? Come on in. We have no jobs for you now, but we'll have even fewer jobs for you next year.
Yeah, and that's very true in Sweden. I'll always come back to Sweden, a country that I've loved very, very much in my life. But there are no jobs for these people. There was a riot this past week in Sweden at one of the asylum centers. Folks saying, number one, we're mad because we didn't get houses and we're in these apartments. But number two, we don't have jobs. And without jobs and a house, we can't get girls. And without jobs and a house and girls, what's life worth living? So they burned down the asylum house and, kept the folks working there hostage. And, you know, it's a big mess.
Well, anytime you have a large group of unmarried young men in your society, you have trouble.
Absolutely.
You have trouble.
Yeah.
And this has been very, very clear all throughout history. You could not design a system more perfectly calibrated to destabilize society.
I know. It's almost funny, except it's tragic, but you're right. It couldn't have been planned better for destruction and decimation of society if we had tried on purpose to do it.
Well, and a lot of it needs to be laid at the blame of it. A lot of it needs to be laid at the feet of women. Women are consistently voting for larger and larger government. Women consistently, in general, vote for open borders. If you look at the breakdown of votes for nationalistic or sovereign movements in Europe, significantly more men than women vote for sovereignty and control over immigration, and significantly more women than men vote for open borders and bigger and more government and open immigration and all that.
I know. I have, you know, all of my liberal friends who know, some I haven't told because I'm getting tired of losing friends, but all of my friends who know I voted for Trump aren't my friends anymore. They don't want to have anything to do with me.
Like you're in league with the devil, right?
I'm in league with the devil. I'm a racist. I'm going to be joining the stormtroopers, coming to get them in the night. And, you know.
And these are mostly female friends?
Yes, all female friends, yes. And they all believe in open borders and welfare, and the more immigrants we can take in, the better, and et cetera, exactly what you just said. So I find myself...
Why do they? Why?
You know, I have to say that I was there myself a few years ago. I wasn't awake enough to see what was really going on. And it's very easy to move into that space where you just want to help people. You know?
Well, sure. But I mean, why does helping people mean moving them to your country?
I know.
I mean, why doesn't helping people mean helping them relocate in the vast expanse of Saudi Arabia or any of the other Muslim countries where I think they'd be much more at home and wouldn't be so frustrated? I mean, that there are women there apparently who can marry them.
Yes. And in fact, we can help. I think with the UN figures and things, we can help 12 people in place for every one that we move to the West. So it's actually more helpful to help them in place than to move them to the West. But you know, what can I say, Stefan? These are smart women. You know, they're college educated. Most of them have master's degrees.
Well, that's why. I mean, they've just been exposed to so much more lefty propaganda, right?
Yeah, and that could very well be. And, you know, I feel for my daughter. She's been exposed to a lot of this propaganda.
I got to tell you, I mean, I think I can speak for more than a few men in this area. As a white male, for many decades, being told that I'm sexist, misogynistic, patriarchal, privileged, and that I need to have more respect for women, I need to treat women better, and all of that. And having been at the receiving end of massive shrapnel-filled cannonfuls of scorn and hostility from certain segments within the female community for being unenlightened and being a male chauvinist pig and this, that, and the other. Mm-hmm. I got to tell you, this is not so much for you, but for the ladies out there, I got to tell you, it's a little frustrating seeing women welcome, after scorning white men for so long, seeing women welcome with open arms a truly medieval doctrine with regards to women's rights.
Yeah, I know. It's unfathomable.
I mean, that, I don't understand it.
I don't either.
I don't understand. Like, I cannot fathom it. Seeing the left, of course, oh, gay rights, fantastic. But then let's bring in a lot of people from Saudi Arabia. Are you kidding me? like, what?
Where they hang gays, literally.
No, it's literally like the hottest woman in town, you know, just won't date you because she heard you may have once said something harsh to a woman. Not true, but let's say she heard that. She won't date you because you got to treat women with respect. And you know who she ends up marrying? The guy who beats her up.
Although that
I don't understand it. I fundamentally, I can't I can't fathom it. And you know, I don't know if you can either, but
Well, on the personal scale, I would say it might be family of origin issues. So a woman who chooses somebody who beats her up, I would say there are issues from her family early on that she's not dealt with. But on the larger cultural scale is where it's unfathomable to me. I don't understand why the folks who say they're for equal rights for women and gays and minorities and Jews and Christians and all of that are bringing in people who trample on those very rights.
Why isn't all criticism of white men pushed back against as patriarchy phobia?
Yes.
don't be such a patriarchy phobe. Don't be such a masculine phobe.
We should.
Don't be such a penis phobe.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
I could do that for about 20 minutes. So let's keep okay, moving okay. as best yes. we can. Yes. But why? I mean, why? Why is it that if there are criticisms of, you know, some pretty repressive aspects of us, that phobic. But why is it that when white males are criticized, nobody pushes back and like, that's all true. It's all valid. I mean, women couldn't try if they want, like, I sat down and draw out one of these Kalogi plans. They couldn't sit down and design a plan that would make men dislike them more than this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because at some point, it may well happen that women don't like the new things that are going on.
Oh, it's definitely. there's.
And then who are they going to run to?
Yeah.
Save us, men!
Yeah.
And I got to tell you, I mean, reading the comments, there are a lot of men who are like, nope! No thank you. Because you had family courts eviscerate us, you divorced our dads, you took them for everything that they had, you're sitting pretty on alimony and child support, and you badmouth men all the time, and you refused to stand up for us, and we got thrown in jail more, and we got broken up more, and bad things happened to us, and you let everybody insult all the men in your life. Why the hell would we fight for you?
Yeah. And now, I think I saw your tweet today, but I saw the article before I saw your tweet about that class in Wisconsin for young men in college, essentially brainwashing them about how awful their masculinity is. I think it was Wisconsin.
Right. So if patriarchy is bad, why is criticizing patriarchy in Islam called Islamophobia? Because I think it's fairly safe that there might just be a shade or two more patriarchy in Islam than there would be in the contemporaneous West. Just, you know, I'm no expert, but just going from what I've read and heard, just a little, maybe just a coat or two more of paint of the patriarchy.
Yeah.
So, but we all know. I mean, so I don't, the betrayal of the women, that is the downfall of the West, fundamentally. Men get it. And why do men get it? Because if there's going to be conflict, it's the men who are going to be drafted. Right? So women are like, oh, you know, we'll just get pregnant. Whatever, right? I mean, so this betrayal of the West by women in particular, I think is, I mean, women, it's still a democracy. Women live longer. They outvote men. They vote more reliably and they vote more towards the left. They vote more for open borders and bigger government. What can men do?
Yeah.
Can't. Right. I mean, I've had these messages from people in Europe saying, "Yo, we'd love to fight, but we can't fight everyone. We can't fight the academics. We can't fight the government. We can't fight the women. We can't fight the media. We can't, like, at least the people who went off to World War II, they had the support of everyone at home."
Oh, they did. Oh, gosh, I remember. Not that I was alive then, but what I've read about it, they did.
Right.
They did.
Yeah, so this just of those, well, you know, trending. Universities work to purge male students of their toxic masculinity. I wonder why that's a picture of a white guy. Why isn't that a picture of an imam? Because, you know, toxic masculinity, I wonder why they're not Yeah, campuses hosting training sessions, group meetings, lectures, and other programs to effectively cleanse what many campus leaders and left-leaning scholars contend is an unhealthy masculinity in young men today. Now, I don't understand that at all, because women have been in charge of raising men for the past two generations at least. So how could there be toxic masculinity left when single moms and daycare teachers and primary school teachers, women? Women have been raising men for two generations. If men are so toxic, I don't understand. See, if men are still toxic after women have been raising them for two generations, guess what, ladies? Masculinity is not environmental and can't be fixed. But if it is environmental, then men are toxic because they've been raised by women. In which case, more nagging probably isn't going to help the problem. Oh, and I also wonder, if men are so toxic, gosh, you know, if men are so toxic, I'm sure that women are going to boycott calling the police when they get in trouble. Because, you know, you can't call a policeman because he's a man. He's so toxic. It's terrible.
Yeah. Or a fireman. Yeah, right. Or an aid worker.
Yeah. What women need to do is boycott stuff made by men. Just boycott it all. Running water, roofs, plumbing, cars, just boycott it all. It's so toxic. It's got all this testosterone all over it. You could get poisoned. Just stay away from everything that men have produced. Just go wherever it is. You can find something not invented or maintained or built by a man and be free of all this toxic masculinity that, I don't know, has bears not chew your boobs off on a regular basis because you're in the woods. I mean, I get you don't need thanks every morning. Oh, man, thank you for building the civilization that keeps us safe. Just maybe not taking this giant menstrual dump on men on a regular basis. That's all I'm asking for, just a little bit of a cessation of that. Or, good Lord, most taxes are paid by men. You better boycott government money because that's also tainted with masculine money. The money's got testosterone on it. You're going to get cooties. No welfare, no child support. And child support and alimony payments, the laws were passed by men. It's generally enforced by men. The men are arrested by other men. It's just a big giant cog in toxic masculinity. You've got to boycott not only the stuff that's built and maintained by men, but government money, the welfare state, alimony, child support, all masculine, all patriarchally enforced. Boycott it all. Yeah, I'll be waiting for that to happen.
Yeah, it's a really weird dynamic. It's a very, very difficult, unfathomable dynamic, actually.
It is chilling how easily most women can be turned against the men in their society. Mm-hmm. Like, whatever happens in society in the future, this can't be unseen. This can't be unpilled. Mm-hmm. There's no going back. And this, because there's the internet, because there's the manosphere, because there's men's rights movements and so on, this knowledge is spreading in a way that it never spread before.
Yeah.
That women are just turning against white men and attacking and undermining and siding with the enemies and inviting in the enemies. This can't be unseen, whatever happens in the future. And that the cultures and societies...
I'm sorry, what was that? I missed it. What?
Well, and the cultures and societies that treat women like crap are winning. Mm-hmm. That can't be unseen either. So, yeah, I don't know what's going to happen, but whatever is going to happen, I think men are going to have a very tough time in the future saying to women, yeah, let's give you a lot of political power because you did a great job with it last time.
Yeah, you know, it's the funniest thing. In my earlier years, of course, feminism was something very different many, many years ago than it is today. So I'm 60. So, you know, it was very different way back yonder. But
well, and sorry, no, you were, sorry, I thought you'd finish your thought. Please go on.
Yeah, I was going to go on with that, but no, you go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say that in a free society, the general social trends would be determined by, you know, by ambition, by resource acquisition and resource management of wealth and so on and all of that. In a society, men would still have, I think, a little bit more influence because there would be men would accumulate more wealth because men would be out there gathering resources for the women who were having children, you know, as in ye olden days. So I think men would have a little bit more influence, and I think it would be proportional to the danger. But this sort of one-for-one thing where women have power without responsibility, I don't know that that's going to be replicated in the future. Either way, that's not going to last. I mean, either some other ideology takes over and women's right. rights are out the window anyway, or, you know, after a sort of bitter struggle, the people who reshape things in the future are going to have learned some kind of lesson. But and I don't blame women for this at all. I mean, it's natural. I mean, men have had sort of massive consequences in political action for tens of thousands of years. You know, you get the wrong leader, he takes you to war and you die like a dog in the ditch, you know. But women have had political power for really less than a century. And they've used that political power to shield themselves in general from consequences. Oh, did you choose the wrong man? Oh, well, that's okay. You can divorce him and we'll just give you welfare, or we'll get him to pay you alimony and child support and so on. Oh, you're dissatisfied in your marriage. You go, oh, did you get pregnant out of wedlock and the guys run off? That's fine. We'll take, right? So women have generally used the state, and I'm generalizing here enormously, but women have generally used the state to escape consequences when they can. And that is perfectly natural as well. It's not like women are bad or anything. It's just this is the way that things have gone down for various reasons. So, but that is this sort of betrayal, this feeling that you can't trust your women, that you can't understand where their allegiances are. You can't understand why your women treat you with such contempt while worshiping groups that would treat them 1,000 times worse than the worst thing they've accused you of. And it's like, it's gross and very disturbing. And again, it can't be unseen.
Mm-hmm. And there are some men now beginning to stand up, which has been really beautiful to see, and be proud of their masculinity and their manhood, just like their Americans now who are proud of being Americans. So some kind of tide is shifting that way. It seems slow, but it does seem to be shifting a bit. And, you know, maybe in part to folks like you and some of the other folks who put a lot of their work and energy into bringing these facts to the wider audience.
Yeah, and people need to shield their children from toxic academia. You know, I'm acutely aware that if my daughter goes to college and she goes into some artsy field, and things haven't changed by then, I mean, it may only be 8 years from now, right? I know exactly what she's going to be taught about me. I know exactly what she's going to be taught about me. What kind of person I am, as the result of my race, as the result of my gender. But what is she going to be taught about the moral content of my character based upon collective concepts like yeah. race and gender?
Yeah.
I would view that as extremely toxic.
Oh, yeah.
A toxic yeah. substance to expose her to. You know, if she wants to become a doctor, then there's things, you know, she has to go through to become a doctor, and I think that's, you know, natural. But I'll tell you this, I will strongly counsel her to stay away from the social sciences and the arts these days. They are not about education anymore. They're about brainwashing, programming, and you're basically being absorbed into an ivory tower kind of cult that is just teaching you to hate an entire segment and race and gender in the population. And I would view that as an extraordinarily and the letters I've gotten from people whose kids have gone off to college and have fallen down this infinite well of leftist hatred and abuse and so on, it's heartbreaking. you know, what happened to my little girl? What happened to my little boy? You know, they come home, I don't recognize them. They're full of all these weird ideas. They criticize everything about me. I can't get through to them. I can't, you know, everything that happened before has vanished. I mean, it's chilling. It's chilling. And I think we bloody well got to keep our kids away from these indoctrination camps.
Yes. Well, and my daughter, who hates the West, you know, her IB program and her degree in colonial literature, she hates the West. She thinks the West is just as good destroyed, better off destroyed. Tragic.
Well, she doesn't really want to be free then, right? Because if the West is destroyed, women's rights are destroyed. They're not around in the non-Western countries in particular. So she's just like, well, I tried this freedom thing. I don't really think it's for me. And this, of course, is particularly enraging because, of course, the women say, well, we don't want to have anything to do with patriarchy. So we're going to work very hard as we can, as hard as possible to destroy the least patriarchal, most egalitarian society the world has ever seen and replace it with what?
It beggars the mind. It just really does.
Well, this, of course, it goes back to the old suspicion that people have had for a long time. And again, this is generalizations, but the suspicion that women confuse feeling for thinking and that thus are more easily programmed to turn against their men and their culture and the culture that, I mean, does she think she'd get to go to college in Iraq?
Yeah, right. Well, she spent 3 months in Egypt by herself studying Arabic a few years ago. And she came out of that experience and said, I never thought I was racist before, but she was sexually assaulted every day on the street, men groping her every single day. She felt smothered. But
she still wants the West to be destroyed and she still wants people from Egypt to come. I don't quite understand. Does she miss it?
Yeah, and she's a bright young thing too, so.
Wait, so she went to Egypt. She was groped every day.
Yep.
And she's pro-migrant. I guess some are coming from Egypt. And she's against the West, where I assume she was not groped every single day, at least not by white males.
Right, right. I wish I could explain it, Stefan.
Does she miss the does she miss the groping?
You know, I think I'm going to have this conversation with her because I've actually been thinking about it. And I'm wondering what her experience in London is.
It depends where she goes, right?
Yeah, that's very true, actually.
Yeah. Depends where she goes. Yeah. You know, I made this argument, I think more than a year ago, that if Angela Merkel is very keen on having all these Middle Easterners come in, it's no problem. All she has to do is go and live in one of the no-go zones with a GoPro somewhere attached to her, and then just broadcast stream for 2 weeks, and just everyone can see what a wonderfully culturally enriched experience she's going to have. And I think that would put a lot of people's minds at ease. Wow.
Yep.
Wow. Now, so she has a problem with Western men, and I assume that she thinks that Western men are sort of patriarchal and misogynistic and this and that and the other.
Oh, but, you know, I'm going to say no on that one. And,
oh, good.
And she's in a lovely, lovely relationship with a very lovely, hardworking young man. And she appreciates and loves her father. And she's wouldn't say anti-feminist, but she's hasn't bought into that bit, at least.
Oh, good. I'm thrilled to hear that. That's absolutely wonderful.
Yeah.
But she still wants the West to die.
You know, everything's our fault, right? So it's the propaganda that she got in the education that I arranged and paid for her. So.
Right.
Yeah.
It's kind of a bitter pill to swallow, too, isn't it?
It's a very bitter pill to swallow. So.
Well, if she gets her way, if the West ever rises again, it will be a never forget moment that it was the treachery of women that had a lot to do with the downfall of the West. And that is something that I think we're all going to need to have a long chat about at some point. But speaking of which, I should get on to the next caller, but I really, really do appreciate the call.
Thank you very much.
Most enjoyable, most engaging, and I hope we can talk again at some point.
Okay. Thank you, Stefan.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.